Hi there, I'm Matthew from the Rhodes Business School. We've just had the Transformation Summit and we've spoken quite a lot about fees. This is something that is the perennial problem at Rhodes University, and I thought it would be worthwhile to share what we spoke about with the university community. That's what it's all about. So let's start off with the leading question. Why are we here? Why do we have a university? Right, there are 1 million disabled people in South Africa, all on grants. There are 3 million AIDS orphans, all on grants, and there are 10 million more children who need a grant. That's the entire top row of the South African flag. Then come the students, just 1 million of them, a small block in the flag. But we haven't finished yet. Then are 3 million social pensioners who live on 1,400 rand a month. Then come the kids, 7 million whose parents can support them, not on grants. Notice there are more people on grants than not on grants. So the flags are full. Wait, I'm going to do better. I'm going to put 18 million down at the bottom, all unemployed or economically inactive. Then we come to those who have a job. But when we look at those numbers, half the people in South Africa who have a job don't earn enough to pay tax. So then we are left with the taxpayers. And 5 million of them earn below 500,000 rand per annum. Then come, right at the top, a group, and they say, we're the cornerstone, we're the wealthy of South Africa. If you want, we're the mortar in the wall. They go down the bottom there, 1 million out of 56 million. What is fascinating about this flag is we have 1 million students and 1 million taxpayers. And the students are aspiring to move from being dependent to right up to the top of the wealth spectrum in South Africa today. And that's very dear to them. But they've got to watch out and say, look at all the dependents in this matrix. And it's getting worse, because our population keeps on growing. So our national development plan is based on the grey line there. It says we won't get to more than 60 million. We're nearly there already, we're at 56 million. By 2030, there will be more than 65 million people in South Africa, and that's 6 million more than the national development plan even contemplates, and Trevor Manuel is on retirement and nobody's working on a new plan. So when you put all of this together, we say, on a National Treasury study, they say if we don't create 9 million new jobs in South Africa, good jobs, in the next 50 years, we risk declining into social chaos. That's what it's about, because what are we going to fix this with? We've taken all the minerals out of the ground. The rest we can't burn because then they'll stuff up the environment. So where's the potential? The potential is in our people. Unless we can improve our people to make them more productive, we've got a problem. This was identified by Mandela years ago when he said, the greatest weapon that we have is education. And then we've had the legendary French rock star economist Thomas Piketty banging off about it. He's saying, education and technology. That's what it's all about. Well, I ask the question, where's the education and technology going to come from? The leadership can only come from the universities. The universities are our sole hope to save South Africa. And this is recognized by the Commission of Inquiry into Higher Education. They've said, well, we need more. We must just double the budget. But it's not as easy as that, because we've got to say, yes, what Piketty and Mandela and nearly every politician is saying is that education increases the marginal productivity of labor. And from that, all good things can come. Yes, we can increase GDP, we can increase employment, we can even increase tax collections, we can decrease inequality. And all of those good things, they come from education, yes. So when we look at the post-school budget And that's where the bang for the buck really comes from. We're spending about 77 billion rand on it in South Africa today. But that doesn't all go to universities. We have to first of all deal with vocational training and skills development levy and training. That's taking up 40% of the budget. Then comes the NSFAS intervention. Then comes the government subsidy, and then we're going to build a few more universities. If we look at what government is doing, they're saying we have to increase the direct interventions in the form of NSFAS. And they've put a hell of a lot more money to it. The problem is we're not getting it through. But are we forgetting something else? We also have to say, Section 29 of the Constitution, which we hopefully all respect, says, all South Africans have a right to basic education, including adults. And then it goes further, and it says, the state will make higher education progressively more available. Why? There's not enough money to go all around. And this is what the Commission of Inquiry is missing. Because, to be fair to government, they've already put a hell of a lot more to higher education. We are increasing the higher education budget by faster than anything else in South Africa. But there comes a point where one spends so much money on higher education that you are invading the constitutional rights of the poor of South Africa. So we can't just give it all away. There is no way that free fees for all can be pro-poor in the context of South Africa. This leaves Rhodes University awfully exposed. Our university is already the second most dependent university in South Africa on student fees. But these are not just South African problems. French economist Thomas Piketty, in his work, he looks at this whole question of education. He says, the world has gone mad, because if you take the income deciles from the poorest to the richest, the children of the poorest have the lowest attendance rates in higher education. And when you move up the board to the richest deciles, all their kids go to higher education. So the obvious answer is to say, well, let's have a direct intervention in the form of a NSFAS down the bottom there, and we will pay for them. We need something for the missing middle and stuff off the top. That's a great idea in practice, but it's very difficult to implement in South Africa. In 2007, the legendary economist Atkinson, please don't think that this is the dietitian, this is the economist, he says, in South Africa, if you inflate his figures, the top 10% of earners earn more than 150,000 rand per annum. And if you want to be in the top 1% of South Africa, you earn more than 600,000 rand per annum. So that explains the missing middle. Their families have income between 150,000 and 600,000 rands per annum. That doesn't make a university education affordable to them or accessible to them, because they've got to pay tax, they've got to pay medical aid, they've got to create their own pension plans. What it means is that if you earn more than 600,000 rand a year in South Africa, you are relatively wealthy compared to the rest of the country. Now take those income deciles and apply them to South Africa students. In yellow are not all the students who can't get to university because they can't afford it. Those are our students who don't have a good enough basic education to get into university in any event. What's going to happen to them? Are they just going to sit there forever? And this is where the university has to provide the leaders so that those people can also have a future in South Africa. In red are the students who are not getting to university for whatever reason. And then very frighteningly in green are those that are at university. And we see that 57% of students at university in South Africa today come from the top 10% income decile. That's incredible, but it still doesn't mean that they can afford it. So what we are saying in South Africa is that the state intervention, call it NSFAS, has to provide for 90% of the population. And then comes the top group where we have to do something else. But please respect that the students are mere 5% of all South Africans in education. Isn't that credible? 1 million out of 20 million. Absolutely stunning. So what can Rhodes University do about this with no money facing an uncertain future? We've got to say our interventions have to be designed for the very poor, the missing middle, and the wealthy. So let's start off with what's going to happen with the very poor in South Africa. And their hope must fall on the ISFAP project. That is a new project that's being designed to improve and enhance NSFAS. It is a public-private initiative. It is on trial at the moment. And the idea is to provide a group of interventions based on grants for the poor, based on funding for the missing middle. And we've got to see how that is going to roll out. There is no way from the money of Rhodes University that we can pay for all the very poor to come to Rhodes. Otherwise, we would have already done it. The money is just not there. So when it comes to interventions for the very poor, what we have to say is, large-scale free fees at Rhodes will sink the university. We know that. That is a mathematical certainty. But that does not mean that we can't say we can make life more comfortable for those from the very poor who are subsidized by the NSFAS projects to come to Rhodes and have a better life. So we have to design interventions, targeted interventions that get the money to where it's needed. And that is the most important thing. But there's more. There are external funding possibilities for students. But how do they get to them? I personally think somebody should get a medal if they get a NSFAS bursary. How do you understand all that paperwork? We've got to make interventions whereby we can help people in applying for funding. Where is it? How do you get there? And we can do interventions like this, which hopefully will help. Then comes the issue of the missing middle. And there are a lot of missing middles at Rhodes. First of all, we've got to find out who are they. And that survey work is going on at the moment. But the missing middle do have something in common. They all have an employer. And this is something that has been forgotten in all that is fees must fall. What about not the rights of students? What about the rights of employees? There are all sorts of interventions that we can use here. And we've got to say, hang on, will the private sector please get involved in what we are doing? So we take it in a different context. A university is a group of contributing stakeholders. They're the students. There is the university. There are the employers, and there is government as well. Employers, please come to the party. You are one of the primary users of what we are creating. And we mustn't have a situation where employers are just sitting out there and saying, well, we'll employ the best. They've got to come in here and grow the best as well. So what we've got to say is that in the past, we looked at interventions at employers at university as a recruitment strategy and maybe a job retention strategy. We've got to say no. Employers, there are incentives available for you to get involved in all that is the rebuilding and transformation of our universities. You have got to look after your employees. Why does the Income Tax Act have Section 101Q, which says, okay, there's a limit on how many bursaries you can give your staff, but you can pay for your staff to come to university. If somebody wants to do an MBA at Rhodes, well, the employer should be paying for it because that's a tax-free fringe benefit. But then they've also got to go and say, well, at undergraduate level, there have been new incentives created, and the level of these incentives has been growing. So any employee who earns less than 600,000 rands per annum can get a tax-free bursary structured into their remuneration of up to 60,000 per annum. That reduces the cost of attending university by up to 25 or 30%. Employers, you've got to facilitate that. And we've got to go further in our community and enhance the level of our basic education. Because employers, please, there is also the issue of giving a bursary of up to 20,000 Rand per annum to attend a school. Now, that won't get you into St. Andrews, but it might be very useful in getting more people into the higher public schools. A lot of things we can do there. Then there is the BEE code. And the BEE code also incentivizes education. It says, hang on, there is skills development. You have to spend money on skills development. And if you go down into that code and you mine into it a bit, that includes the granting of bursaries. So, corporate social investment has a BEE spin on it. And we should be saying, come, let's talk about that in getting more people into university. And then after that comes the CETA system. There's 15 billion Rand a year flying around that system. And there are ways that employers can get huge refunds through the CETA system. But it's also complicated and spread all over South Africa that nobody digs down into it. Nobody claims it. Nobody gets there. There's a lot that we can do with this. And then interventions for the wealthy? Well, everybody says, well, can that one, Matthew? No. The wealthy is 600,000 and above. That does not mean that all the wealthy could get their children to university. We have to design interventions there. They don't have to be grants. We have to facilitate funding for those people. If you can buy a car, you can borrow. But we have to manage borrowing. There is healthy debt and unhealthy debt. We need to understand how that works. So with all these incentives, surely there's more that we can do. We have to ask the question now, where's the money going to come from to do all of these good things? And there is a problem at Rhodes on this, in what's called third stream income. Now, first stream income is your student fees. Second stream income is your state subsidies. The third stream income is the other incomes of university that we get from research grants, donations, trading. And we see that as a national average on that, 23% in South Africa. But Rhodes, 7%. We don't do that. It's not all Rhodes' fault. Living in an obscure valley in the Eastern Cape, we're not in the business centers, which makes it a lot easier for the likes of the UCTs and Stellenbosch. But there's a lot more that can be done. And then there is also the issue of donations. Look at it. Stellenbosch and UCT getting about 1 billion rand a year in donations. Rhodes University right down. Why? Our alumni are poorer. But we have to do a huge amount more in keeping contact with our alumni. How can they help us? Maybe I don't want a donation from a younger alumni. Maybe if he can open a door for the university to generate more third stream income, then there's a lot we can do. So we take that and we say, well, what's the university been doing about it? It was discussed in 1999 extensively at Rhodes. Nothing happened. Then in 2009, much research was done on this subject, and it was discussed by all the vice chancellors at a separate conference, and nothing happened. This needs to be exploited a lot further, again, in bringing in the corporates into this problem. We also have to look internationally to the big money in America to say, come here, Africa's got problems, we need your help. So what is needed at Rhodes? And I'm going to attack this in a slightly different manner. You look at it like this. You say, Rhodes, like any institution, is run by a governing body. That's what we call the council. And the council has to take ownership of the problem and find the knowledge, skills, experience, and resources to make it all happen. They've got to take ownership of the problem. They've got to treat the university as being, if you want, a disabled person. They've got to help it. They've got to get the resources. They've got to come up with a charter or game plan as to how we are going to enhance student fees and third stream income. And probably there are a lot of plans that need to be added to that in the council's charter. And we've got to say, now take that. And we say, given the poor performance of Rhodes and our crisis at the moment, the governors can't do it all. You have to create a committee. That's what King IV is recommending. We need to constitute a committee with the skills that can go out, find solutions to the problems, and then report back to the council. That's how modern governance works. If you look at what goes into a committee today, it is a hell of a lot more than recruiting a bunch of crusty academics to give their views. In fact, the academics are not independent. We have to get the specialist knowledge. The council needs to facilitate that. We need to get the people together to open the doors and address these problems. There's a lot that can be done if we follow the modern way of governing a university. That in the old days, we had vice chancellors. They drove the bus. They laid down the law. Today in modern governance, no, we don't have one man running an institution. That's the old way of doing it. We need to say, a vice chancellor is part of a council. Council, please provide the direction. So what do you think of that? I'm Matthew Lester at the Rhodes Business School. We would like to get involved in facilitating and helping Rhodes solve its problems. We've had bigger problems in our past, and we still have a great potential for the future. Thank you for watching this lecture.